Hello and welcome to all of our loyal viewers to the 6th round of the Super GT series at Fern Bay Gold, or FE3 to those of you who love your prefixes. Today we're going to be covering the qualifying race, which is coming up next, currently in the gridding process for that. We should then bring you mixed coverage for qualifying. We'll have someone commenting on the goings-on in the GT300 server and probably a live broadcast from the GT500 server. That'll be shortly followed by the main race, which will include the teams that qualify in this qualifying race, which is the top five in both classes. Although it does appear that there is only one class in action today. I've only just picked up on that. It looks like it's a GT300 only qualifying race. I'm just being informed of the current situation with GT500 cars, and there only being five of them still active means that they're automatically locked in. Five active in terms of those that would be in the qualifying race. No need for them to be driving around and crashing into each other then. Might get to see some close racing. It looks like we're going to have 12 GT300 cars running a nifty 25 lap race. Low wind, that could be anything between, I believe it's something like 4 and 20 kilometers an hour, and at any track that can really mess around with your tire wear. Now, I'm not going to be here for the whole time today, so helping me out and probably pushing the broadcast along a lot more than I will do today is Michael Booth.
Hello.
And he'll be covering the majority of this qualifying race. And I should be back for qualifying in the main feature. Pole position for this race, we've got James Peace. Behind him, we've got Dimitriov. We've got Bertoni, I believe that's of Mafia Racing. Closely followed by Garbalowski. I'm just going to check who Garbalowski is racing for today. Still Conquest. I would have thought Conquest didn't have to qualify, but there we go. Behind him, we've got Lobato, who's going to be at Scuderia Gas. Then we've got Last Lap Motorsports, and we've got, well, excuse my pronunciation on this one, Larikov, driving that number 57 car. Behind them, we've got Rassinen for Piri Motorsports, followed close by the Hellenic Racing Team car, being driven by Purs today. Number 78, Gravity Racing car, being driven by Martinson. It's the first time that I've seen them field a GT300 entry. Our own loyal Chris Ford is going to be behind them in the Met Racing car, colourfully skinned with a Nyan Cat on it today. That's number 86. In what is going to be 11th position on the grid is Kalita, and that is for, I believe, World Crash League, but I could be wrong. And rounding out the grid for this qualifying race is Lopez in the number 87 car. Okay, been given a 30-second countdown to the start. I'm going to hand over to Michael Booth now. And I hope that it is absolutely action-packed.
Well, luckily we've also got Philip Diaz here, who's doing the stream, so he can say some stuff as well, while I also say things.
And we're on. And they're off. Some contact in turn one. One car went off, that's LLM. Sorry, another car went off. Old Crash League ended up on the hill. Come onto the bridge for the first time. I don't know if these cars have enough slipstream to cause any problems. I would imagine they do though. Wow. James Peace has already lengthened his lead ridiculously after the first lap. World Crash League has retired already. I wonder if these guys know that this race is actually longer than normal. There's no GT500s. They're not getting lapped and Conquest goes off, as you just seen. Looks like James Peace went off from the lead. Spertoni makes a pass on Dimitriev. Oh, is there almost a roll in the back? He actually could have rolled. I'm not sure yet. His roof is damaged though. He's on his wheels. I think our very own Chris Ford had a little help in that one. James Peace sets the fastest lap. Oh, and a whole bunch of cars are off for the bridge.
Oh, I've just had a look at the start of the race.
Oh, Chris Ford just got crashed. Big crash on the bridge.
Oh, I can see it on the bridge. Big crash, yep.
Looks like Gravity just, like, didn't slow down. Oh, they're still getting hit. They're still crashing into each other.
Some pretty poor driving there to crash after the cars are already crashed. Missing, ignoring the yellow flags by some cars there.
For sure. I think LLM actually slowed down. That's why their front end's not completely smashed in.
Yeah, as I was saying before that, I just checked the wind and it was 21 kilometers per hour. And it's in a sort of headwind on the start-finish straight, which does give a bit of a tailwind into the fast corners, which could make it quite tricky for the racers here.
Yeah, I actually think that's going to push them off the track more. It's probably why they're having problems right now. Pretty sure almost every car has went off there. Forgot about wind. I knew a slipstream would be a problem, but wind just adds a whole new category of randomness in.
Well, Scuderia of Gas and, oh god, Hellenic Racing Team have crashed coming out of the fast sweeping corners there onto the bridge, so it's really all changing here. Ben Keogh was telling me a minute ago that the guy who flipped has now got back into fifth. The top five being the five cars who go through to the main race in about an hour's time, hour or so time.
Yeah, this race is a lot longer than expected because of the no GT500s. So hopefully we can still make it on time. Martinson for Gravity have retired.
I think he was last anyway, and he'd probably been damaged and involved in those crashes on the bridge.
Yeah, basically, can't remember who was in fourth at the time.
Oh, number 67, that is maybe...
57?
Sorry, 87, Herber Racing Team. The MG-coloured FXR spun coming onto the bridge, so...
He's in fifth.
Yeah, they're going to have to try and hold on to their fifth place.
Oof. Oh, look, Masters of Endurance.
Five laps gone, that's a fifth of the race so far. We've got James Peace with quite a bit of a lead for Team Virus. Second, we've got, with another bit of a lead over their competitors, is Mafia Racing. Dimitrov of Blowing Pistons team is just struggling to hold off Perry Motorsport as he goes defensive down into the corner after the bridge. Makes a bit of contact, but yeah, uses the FXR bus power to get out of the corner pretty decently. After that, there's a bit of gap back to Lopez of the Herb Racing team in their FXR. And then the five, there's basically four cars behind who are all pretty close, and they know that they've got to get up and catch Lopez to have any chance of getting through to the main race.
I'm wondering if that the front end of the Conquest car is scraping, mainly through the fast section, because I know it dips down, and if it's hitting the ground, that's just going to push them wide every lap. But yeah, the start on the bridge, it looked like car went off in the grass. I think it was actually Scuderia gas. They went off into the grass, and then Chris had to slow down for him, and then Grab T got in the back of Chris, and all three of them went off. And the bridge isn't exactly wide, so everyone just piled in after that. Actually had to pass for third. Perry has got around Glowing Pistons by a large margin. Chris is actually on the back of Lobato.
Yeah, he's eventually picked up a bit of pace. It takes a few laps to get used to the damage on an XRR, which normally affects it a bit more than the FZR. Usually on the rear wheels especially.
Yeah, both cars look pretty damaged right now. Bottom runs wide.
I think Chris Ford in the blue Mare Racing car knows that he's got to get past if he's going to have any chance of catching the fifth place car, but Labato
ran too wide.
Yep, Scuderia gas makes a good switchback maneuver there. Check the lap times as they come past from 5th place backwards. Herbo Racing to 19.5. Conquest also 19.5. Last Lap Motorsports to 19.7. Scuderia Gas at 21.4. And Chris Ford at 21.5 for Mare Racing. So it seems like the two at the back, with the penultimate battle really, for 9th and 8th, are holding each other up a bit there. So they need to really, one of them needs to make a break for it and try and catch up to the battle for 5th.
Yeah, Chris is on the back here. He's going to run wide. Yep. Lost a ton of time there. That corner is going to be huge in the race, because when you're close up to someone, you just lose most of your front downforce and you just run wide and just lose so much time. It's easier just to let off before you even get to the corner. Save yourself a bunch of time. Pretty good though. A rolled car possibly locking itself in, and there was no safety car. Starting to look like Garbalowski's catching Lopez a little bit lap after lap. Sadly, I don't have the lap times in front of me, so I'm not entirely sure. Conquest definitely caught the past sector here. Alright, Garbalowski's caught 0.2 of a second on Lopez here. I don't know if that's going to be enough though, unless he does it consistently for 14 laps. I'm starting to wonder though, if they're catching Dmitriev in fourth. Unless he's made a mistake. You see, he has left side damage. But he's not as far ahead as he once was.
Yeah, it seems like Glowing Piston is in fourth. They're actually losing time every lap to all of the cars around them, so they could be in danger if if the if Conquest managed to catch fifth, and fifth managed to catch fourth. So yeah, almost halfway gone in this race.
Looks like Last Lap Motorsports staying up with him. With Conquest, that is.
Chris Ford at the penultimate position does his fastest lap on that previous lap. He's going to have to put quite a few good laps in to manage to catch up to fifth.
Yeah, they're about 11 seconds behind. It's a tall order, and Chris has just retired from the race.
Which is a shame in one way, because it means they won't be racing with Stephen Martin, who did a bit of work for him. They were confident, I think, or they were hopeful anyway that they would get into the main race and have a decent race. But on the other hand, it's good because we get to have Chris to commentate in the main race.
Yeah, hopefully he's not too mad. Yeah, Lopez is definitely catching.
Yeah, Lopez is doing the same time as Garbalowski behind him, but they're both doing quicker times than Dimitrov and Vogel and Pistons in fourth.
Yeah, the wind, they're actually having to let off the gas in that fast right-hander coming onto the bridge. It's surprising for GT300 cars. Also looks like Pirri in third is catching up to Bertone.
So 14 lap gone. Dimitrov for Golden Piston does his fastest lap, which is a 90.93. Unfortunately, that's 6 tenths slower than Lopez behind for Herber Racing Team. The gap is split wide now, just down to 1.5 seconds between fourth and fifth. So although they're both in, I suppose it's a bit of pride you're kind of fighting for here and trying to make sure that you stay ahead of sixth place.
As you can see, Lopez is catching up quite a bit as James Peace sets his fastest lap. Looks like he's pulled away from Garbalowski. Lopez has. I think his car rolling, making him more aerodynamic. Certainly with the wind. Beginning of the race, the wind was blowing with the front straightaway. So you'll have a tailwind down the front straightaway, I believe. Or was it a headwind, Boothie?
It was a headwind, yeah. I think I was going to suggest you have a look at the flags, but since we're in the battle here, as we can see, looking back from Dimitrov, that Lopez is right close to him now. These two don't want to take each other out, because, I mean, they lose their position in the main race, so if I was Lopez, I would either make a clean pass or just sit behind.
Oh.
And that's what he's done. Made a clean pass around the outside of turn one, and that's Herber race up into four. Now Dimitrov just has to stay ahead of Conquest, and they will also be into the main race.
I wonder if Dimitrov has engine damage. There has to be a reason why he's so much slower on the straightaway. But the wind is pushing him out there, you can tell.
He's almost lost it. Just coming onto the bridge there. Just got onto the grab on the edge of the track. And now that's Conquest going up the inside. Bit of a bump, but there's no way you're going to stop that move.
So Conquest moved herself up to fifth. We actually have Oscar Hardwick back in the commentary booth.
Hello.
So I'm guessing you've missed everything, Oscar?
Well, I got here to be watching as Chris Ford presumably gave up on trying and have just announced my presence back in the commentary box.
Maybe you should have a look at the replay and give us your thoughts on the few interesting crashes in the opening couple of laps.
I might do just that.
There was a pretty monster crash coming onto the bridge. That's actually why people like Chris Ford were so far back. And if you see the car in fourth, he has damage on his roof. Why? Because he's rolled over. And somehow he has worked his way back to fourth. Car in front of them. It's Hellenic Racing. They've actually pit once on this race. They're a lap down.
Maybe we could show the viewers the flags in the final section of the track to show them how windy it actually is.
Dang. I actually had it on it. I lost it.
Just as you come out of the final corner.
Yeah, I got it here.
Ah, there we are. Kind of blowing as a headwind, or just slightly off to the left-hand side as you look down the start-finish straight, which means when you go to the back part of the track, you're going with a bit of extra speed, which is tricky with the corners there. The sweeping corners onto the bridge are tricky at the best of times. But with a bit of extra speed, you could be going off onto the gravel and into the wall. Obviously, it could change for the main race and the qualifying session, so that'll be interesting to see.
Yeah, this is pretty much the worst you can have it right now. It's blowing to the side as you go down and take that right-hander. This is like a 2008 IGTC. Very similar. However, we have Dennis Lynn screaming that this means that the wind is actually going southwest. So thank you, Dennis.
Yeah, I'm just watching through this replay at the moment. It looks all far too bunched at the start of the race. I mean, in the first lap and a half, you've already got Conquest and Last Lap Motorsports into a wall and completely out of it, whereas now they're both fairly comfortably placed. Well, not Last Lap Motorsports, but Ah, here we go. Something's about to go horribly wrong. Or is it? I have no idea. It looks like everyone was pretty close on pace and, you know, generally just fighting for their positions. And oh, there goes someone on their roof. And I think it's fair to say that it was all a bit too busy for the best of them.
Peace just doing a bit of practice, it seems, for the main race by setting another fastest lap. He has a 12.95 second lead over second. I think Primo Sport in third have just decided to hold position here behind Mafia Racing, not bother going for it really, because there's no point. Obviously the big difference between this race and the main race that you'll see is there will be an addition of GT500s, so a bit of wind, a bit of lapping cars. What more could you ask for?
Some type of sterilizer to calm me down.
James Peace not wanting to let up any, just setting another fastest lap. Must be said, every time that we have seen Vires out on the track this season, they've always put on a really good show, even if they've had the unfortunate circumstance of timing out come upon them back at South City. They have gone and won very recently. They've been strong every time they've fielded a GT300 car. No struggle for them to be qualified for all of these races.
We're actually having a debate where the sun is coming up and setting.
Surely it would come up in the east and set in the west, like most suns do. James, please. Giving us a bit of a procession at the moment.
He's looking good for the main race. Oh, he's off. Alright, I'm gonna take the camera off of him before I jinx him.
I think you could probably get away with jinxing him a couple of times. He's got plenty of time to make up for any mistakes he does make.
Oh yeah, Dimitrov has retired. Coming into the last lap. He really doesn't want that sixth place finish, I guess.
I can understand his frustration, but you just never know with these things. He was in the strongest position to pick it up if it went wrong for anyone else. Okay, so coming to complete this qualifying race at Fernbay Gold, getting a bit airborne there. In first place, and comfortably so, is James Peace for Virus Racing. In a few moments' time, by a few I mean quite a lot, we're going to have Bertone for Mafia Racing come across the line in second in this qualifying race, followed closely by Rassinen of Piri Motorsports. Further still behind them is Lopez, who's going to...
You have a battle for... Oh no, it's not for fifth, it's for sixth. But... Sure, we've got an entertaining one. To where the line beefs, I've missed it now.
We had Lopez finishing fourth there. We had a battered and bruised car from an early roll. And Garbalowski bringing it home in fifth for Conquest Racing. We get the race complete and... Well... Larikov and Lobato, despite not qualifying, getting together over the finish line just there. Been informed by race control that the number 54 Conquest car will receive a stop-go equivalent penalty for the incident on the back straight. So, I don't know how many seconds that's going to be.
It will be enough to put them back to where they will not qualify for the main race.
In which case, yep, we've just had the confirmation of that now. Last lap motorsports. Proof that... Tell you what. Dimitrov will be kicking himself now for disconnecting when he did. And, but we've got another protest from Lobato. Already flooding in here. Probably one of the more eventful races that we've seen in terms of a qualifying race. Lots going on post-race here in terms of penalties.
I'll tell you why Dimitrov spectated. It's because he rolled.
Oh, that makes substantially
more
sense.
That's a huge crash. What's your normal say, buddy?
Well, it was on his own, so maybe it wasn't such a huge crash. Yep, we just flipped in the final sector. I'm just having a look to see what actually happened in this final lap between 57 and 70, but...
I was watching it very little. 57 squeezed, 70 decided to go to the outside for the fast right-hander after the double left, and then, you know, he didn't push you on the grass, you were on the outside, and he sort of swept across you. I think you have to expect that. Everybody wait, he did nothing wrong.
Yeah, I don't think... He didn't actually push him on the grass, he did put him on the kerb slightly, which, I mean... It's the final few corners of a race. You're not expecting someone just to give you lots of room.
So, with a few more disputes being settled as we speak, having the GT500s join the server. This is going to be their server for qualifying. And the second server will be used for the GT300 qualifying.
Oscar's here.
So, we'll be bringing you qualifying in just a matter of moments. I'm going to be sitting on the GT300 server, which you won't be able to see, but I'll let you know who's setting the times there. And back in the GT500 server, we should still have Michael Booth and Chris Ford covering for you.
No, you'll just have me. Michael Booth's going to shovel some food down his trout.
Yeah, well, in which case, you're one Scotsman down on the GT500 servers, but I'm pretty sure you'll be okay with that.
It's been a huge crash. I did Boothie impressions pretty well, so.
Are you doing Boothie impressions to cheer yourself up after?
I can just see a CSF impressions go even off, even off, even off.
I can do Boothie impressions even better. Oh dear.
Anyway, here. Yeah. Qualifying should be starting in a minute or two, so I'll leave you in the capable hands of Oscar, Christopher, and Philip.
Goodbye, Booty. Pat! Trackers failed. Trackers failed. Booty, before you go, trackers failed.
I think he's already left the building.
Boothie. No, oh well. So we wait to start qualifying.
How can the tracker fail before qualifying starts?
I can't read you because I've got live stream adverts. Okay, turn that down. I don't know what's wrong with the tracker, it seems to just be spazzing out a little bit.
Somebody's saying the tracker is good.
It's good now. So we're just setting up for qualifying for GT500. You will be watching, Oscar Hartwig will be with the GT3s on the other server. It's quite an interesting track, this one, very, very narrow and very, very quick. So expect, just as you saw in the GT300 qualifying race, crashes, pro and add in GT300s. To the mix with the GT500, I expect it to be quite interesting today. Anyway, here we go for that qualifying. Sucks. And they've crashed her in. Well, that's gone well. Well. Now then. I think there's a bit of a crush there as they came out of the pit lane, and well, it's going well. As you'll jockey for position, just 12 second lap for the GT500, on 18 or so for the GT300. So a quick, tight, technical track, adding a bit of wind, it's going to be explosive.
Chris, did you by chance check the wind as the session was starting?
No, I did not. I suppose I can go and check now.
Over on the GT300, we've got 9 miles per hour of wind.
It's not as strong as in the qualifying race then. That was really, really tricky into the right-hander with the wind there. The fast right-hander at the bottom of the hill there, as I'm pretty sure everybody noticed. It's just 4 kilometres an hour here, so nothing at all, basically.
Well, that's GT5 what the GT, that's what the GT500s need, because they're going to struggle a lot more with wind.
Yeah, indeed. I think that they, we saw, well, I don't know, the closeness of the GT300s, that really did cause issues with the wind down into the fast right-handers, I said a moment ago, and it really does sort of create a bit of more engines than I think we'll see in the proper race. Hopefully the wind will not be as effective down there.
Well, people seem to be able to take it flat on the GT300s through that corner, so like presumably the wind direction has also changed here. I've not taken enough note of the direction. I'll try and figure it out.
The final corner flags, well, it's barely anything at all. So really, it's not really worth motoring. I think it's a headwind down toward turn number one. For all the damage it'll be doing for these cars, they come around. It's 12.57 for Vegjarvi for Western Wills, beaten immediately by Gahama for Graf T with a 12.49, beaten immediately by Joe Holmes for 3ID with a 12.34. So it's all action here already. Two FXRs on front of the grid already. I thought this would be a good FXR track for the GT500s, and it seems to be proving that way so far.
Had Renault Coutts throw away his lap.
Of course, in GT500, we're seeing a return to the series for Y3ID Gaming. Oh, what's going on here? Oh, there's a crash. What on earth are we doing here? Why are we going so slowly and crashing into each other? It seems though Holmes wants some space. Two cars come up behind him and sort of ran into him, and well, that was a bit confusing there, that incident there. I mean, that's 3ID in an FXR, which seems a bit strange to look at the moment, but we'll see as it goes on. But and also Evo were in the series for the first time. Car number 29 in the FXR.
Currently ogling the new Sonic Realms racing skin. Big fan of what they've got on their cars this time out. After the first round of hot laps over in the GT300 qualifying session, it is Wong for player zone at the head of the pack.
Difference there, and we've got ready to roll another new team actually that we forgot about there. Phil Diaz, we were going to a second ago. Phil, you can't hear at the moment because he's all back on his main PC rather than his laptop. They're back, well, they're in the series now. They go fourth, Gunsman fifth for Core, Price sixth at the moment for Speedo. Holmes actually goes further onto pole position at 12.12. Missed that one. Bill Holmes in the FXR really showing his worth in the FXR. 0.2 of a second quicker than Vegjarvi, who's gone up to second actually, so I'm missing quite a lot of those things at the moment. Good job. Mm.
Ah, Virus has actually made an appearance in GT500. He actually could time out, as I say that. The difference in FZR and FXR here, besides FXR being all-wheel drive, is the FZR can actually attack the curbs more. The FXR, two turns before the final turn?
Yeah, it'd be quite interesting to see if there's any rollers in this race. We did see some spectacular crashes in the GT300 qualifying race. Do you think there will be many, Phil? Because I could actually see on FXR rolling in GT5 as well.
Yes, right where on screen Perry's going around. That right-hander.
Yeah. There sure to be a roll there. Well, we did see an interesting roll involving Lopez, wasn't it, in the FXR in the first race where he sort of got a bit of a hit with Perry and sort of flew over and under and still finished in fourth. So, yeah, if you land in your wheels, you might get lucky.
Bus power.
Bus power.
Isaac Price set a pretty fast lap.
Bus power doing nothing in GT300 though. The first FXR currently qualified in 9th position.
Yes, Phil, the Price
6th position.
2nd in GT5. How many cars have you got there, Oscar?
I've got 15 cars here.
15 here as well, so that'd be 13.
Been extremely good this season. Full grids every round so far, and do remember this is round 6.
Kilometers now.
I'm surprised actually to see Ready to Roll with an FZR, knowing Genuine's an XRR.
Maybe just want to spread their options, I suppose. And I suppose coming up as well, you've got West Hill reversed, so that's an XR track as well.
Yeah, it's going to be a fun track to watch.
Hopefully I won't get wrecked at qualifying race and I'll be racing that one. Yay!
Yeah, the instant view in the qualifying race was incredibly unlucky on your part.
I got stuck on a wall. I had to reverse. It's amazing. I didn't think I could get stuck on that wall like that and then not be able to move and have to reverse and watch everybody else who hadn't ended up the right way sort of getting back out in front of me. as much fun. But it just sort of shows in SuperGT, you just gotta be aggressive and make big moves. Not sort of poodle around and be cautious as I was trying to do for the first few laps. Oh, hello, Virus GT5 hits a wall with his lag. He is lagging hugely. This is a bit dangerous, I'd have to say.
Yeah, I don't know if that's gonna work in the race.
No, it would work in terms of entertainment purposes.
I think every single GT300 would have a bit of brown coming out every time they saw him coming around them.
Wow.
Oh! Sonic Rams. Spins off.
And Jarvie off there. Don't know what happened there. It seemed like an odd incident. Joe Holmes has increased his pole position to an 11.97. Crikey.
Oh. I don't know what they're doing here. Joe is going slow and Isaac just almost driving to the back of him. I don't know.
I think he was maybe a bit annoyed that Holmes had come out of the pit directly in front of him when he could have waited a little bit longer. But, oh well. I thought that one myself. I was thinking, yeah, that's going to be interesting. It's just so hard to judge here where you come out of the pits, really. It's just such a narrow track. It's hard to get out of the way of everybody.
James Peace, only in 6th at the moment, after that fantastic qualifying race performance.
I don't know if you noticed here, but driving for Core GT500 is Marcus Gunzelman.
Oh yeah, so he is. Formerly of Racestar, sadly had to withdraw a round one winner from the series. He's in 6th position at the moment, 6/10 or so off of Joe Holmes' scintillating pace at the moment. Is this going to be any improvement as 11.97? Oh, 11.98, so very, very close there for Holmes to increase his pole position there. But still, the gap is 2/10. It's 3ID Speedo and then Western Wolves before they're followed by the first FXR of Gahammer for Gravity. And then Ready to Roll and then Core rounding up the top six at the moment. Big disappointments? Well, there aren't too many. Maybe Genuine Racing down in eighth, but that's the top X, or the only XRR actually out on track in GT500s today. Jarvie starting his lap into the chicane, there's a tyre there, that's not going to help him one little bit, hits the tyre. It's not a pro, but it is the fastest first bike that I saw last time, 15.99, so that tyre didn't hinder him too much, which I'm surprised about. No damage on the car as well, so maybe it was a bit of a lag hit. But anyway, down the plunging right-hander onto the bridge complex, now down toward the real only massive braking point on this track. Down to third gear, in and out, quick corner still though. Double left-hander go. Not bad, let's see how this goes for Fent Jarvie, currently third. FXR of Gahammer up in front of him, but he's got a little bit of the oversteer on there as he touched the curb, didn't really want to be doing that. I don't know whether this is going to get him any higher up the grid. Bit sloppy in the final split, but here he comes to the line now. And he does move up to second position just ahead of Speedo Racing. So Western Wolves up onto the front row with 3ID's FXR. And here is our pole position man, Joe Holtz, in the FXR for My 3ID Gaming down onto the bridge complex. And he gives up the lap. So I found him on my own screen. Nope, Price is not on the lap. Message to Phil Diaz, he's on an outlap. Price starts his qualifying run round the first corner up toward the chicane. No tyres for him, unlike Fent Jarvie. Remember that time, 15.99 for Fent Jarvie. This is his last run. It's exactly the same as Fent Jarvie over the first split down to the kinks. Into this tricky downhill right-hander. Hard in any car and for speed. Down onto the bridge complex. It looks smooth at the moment. Don't think it's going to be pole position, though. That looks as though it's comfortably going to be my 3ID and Joe Holmes's. So the battle is really for second place. Bit untidy on the turn in there for Price. It's going to be hard, I think, to beat Fent Jarvie for second. Bit oversteery, and that is the lap gone. He will probably start third. He had the exact same second split as Fent Jarvie as well. And maybe Riegler might be able to move up. He looks to be on a decent-ish lap. Maybe not, actually, looking at the time he's done the second split, 45.74. Be surprised if he moved up from the current fifth position at the moment, and he does not. I think that's everybody done. It is indeed. So we have a grid over here. Oscar, how about you?
Yeah, you got a few cars finishing up. The most prominent of which is Gisella, currently our pole position man. Got another lap left in him. He's not really got any competitors left on track, and his rear tyres are very warm. It's his fourth lap on the trial at the moment. pole position is Gisella, so that's Vortex Racing taking yet another pole position. Got Robin Friskops in the final sector at the moment, looking to move forward a few positions from 6th. Maybe Jump Ivanov is going to have to put in the pretty fast last sector to manage that though. Don't think he'll make it. I think Robin Friskops and Western Wolves GT300 are going to have to settle for 6th position on this one. As he comes up to the line, and it's going to be the last car across the line. Indeed, he does have to settle for 6th position. Not going any quicker than he had gone before now. Everyone's over the line. So we've got Vortex Racing in first. Speedo Racing have come home in second, albeit a full 2/10 behind Vortex Racing. And behind them, it's Wong for player zones. That is FZR, XRR, XRR for the top three in GT300.
And in GT500, it's a pole position for an FXR, a Mike 3D Gaming ticket with Western Wolf second, Speedo third, Grav T are in fourth position, the top, second top FXR, of course. Fifth for Ready to Roll with Core Racing sixth. A full run down the grid as we line up in about 5 or 10 minutes' time. We'll just take a short break, I think, before we come back. You could also look at the tracker, of course, which is up to date with the qualifying positions and times. So we'll see you in a few minutes' time. Thank you. Hello and welcome back to round number 6 of SuperGT 2012 from Fern Bay Gold, a narrow, sweeping, horrifying track if you get stuck in the draft of other cars. Hard track to pass on, hard track to follow a car on. This is going to be interesting, especially when you throw into the mix GT5s coming around to lap GT3s, and we saw exactly what happened at Blackwood, and I think, well, it could be worse today. Let's hope it isn't. Anyway, quick run down the grid. I'll do GT500. Oscar Hardwick, are you okay to do GT300s in a second?
Can't see why not.
Okay, let's just refresh track and see what it says. Okay, so my 3ID are in pole position in GT500 with Western Wolves alongside them on the front row. Speedo Racing and Grav T are 3rd and 4th with Ready to Roll team in 5th. Co Racing I am 6th with Team Evo in 7th position. Genuine Racing and the only XR in the GT500 field are in 8th with the Danger Racing team in 9th. Conquest round out the top 10. Sonic Realms are in 11th with Team Virus in 12th. 13th are Perry Motorsport with Reality Team and Savage Simsport rounding out the GT500 field. Oscar, over to you.
Taking a comfortable pole position in the GT300 field. Once again, I am informed reliably by their team. That's the third time in a row that Vortex have done that. Pole position for them. Second place, Speedo Racing. They've been there a lot this season too. Player Zone, doing a great job bringing it home third. Virus behind them, closely followed by Genuine Racing. Western Wolves fighting to keep their XRR in the top 5, not quite managing it today, but a good effort nonetheless. Angel Power Racing are behind them. Core follows suit. GTS Motorsports, big XRR train going on here, follows Core Racing. Herber Racing Team is in 10th. Sonic Realms Racing is close behind them with Piri Motorsports, Mafia Racing, Last Lap Motorsports and Savage Sim Sports rounding out the GT300 field.
Okay, so we're just filling up the grid now as we wait for the start of this race. Ben Keel giving an instruction to all cars after the qualifying race. If you see a yellow flag, especially on the bridge complex, lift off! Don't charge straight into the back of me! Anyway. Just a little rant there. First one of the day. I'm sure this is going to be a fun race for ranting, isn't it, Oscar?
Only from you. Every time you open your mouth and that tone comes out, I literally cower behind my steering wheel.
My voice is a bit funny today, so I do apologise if I sound even more strange than I normally do. So, we are readying up eventually, I think. And here we go. 14 kilometres an hour. Aw, it's not as good as I expected it to be there, Oscar.
Well, that's the 9 miles per hour that the GT300s had in a qualifying session, I believe.
And it appears to be a crosswind on the start-finish straight.
Which means it's just going to be blowing in their face through the fast right-hander.
Well, sort of, is it? Does it?
No, that's my sense of
it's a crosswind there as well, so that'll be entertaining at the very least for us, I suppose.
Yeah, especially on cold and or overheating tyres. Catch the wind wrong, you're going to go straight off into the wall.
Indeed you are, so here we go around the track, they go. I suppose Western Wolves don't want to immediately try and jump past. It's 53 for some reason, has blocked messages. We'll want to immediately try and jump past Holmes' FXR, because I think an FXR around here is going to be very hard to pass. It's going to be very hard to pass anybody around here, let's put it that way. So really, qualifying, I think, is going to be all important, and trying not to crash into each other is going to be important. It's just... Well, I love watching this track in league races, to be honest. It just throws up some really, really strange events. And I think if you thought Blackwood was good this year, wait until you see this race, I think.
Well, you say it's in their best interest to not crash into each other. Their best interest does not mean that they're going to avoid it that much.
Right, so, yes, I suppose, shall we split up the starting again? Do you want me to do GT5 and you could do GT3?
You can go for that if you want to. Okay, I'll follow GT3 so far.
Okay, then, we shall do that then. We shall stick to our original roles, and we're about to go double file. There's enough room for double file. Do that final chicane. This ought to be entertaining. Safety car has pulled off. Holmes to the right, Fenyarvi to the left, Price and Hammer left to right behind them as we come through this final sector. Short run to the start finish straight. Remember GTL 2010, where we had to red flag the race because there was a massive crash and won the restart, and here we go again. Anybody nervous? You bet we should be. We're getting ready for the green flag to be thrown. Holmes and Fenyarvi, Price and Gahammer ready for the start into this narrow turn one. And the GT500, green flag, Riegler was the one that really made a fantastic start there. Price looks to have made a good start as well, but he's going to get blocked in, I think, slightly by Fenyarvi. And Holmes is contact between all three of them, and off goes Holmes. Holmes has been spun out in the first corner. Unbelievable, he's been going from first to last. Oh, there's a big crash. Big crash into GT500. GT3 is going to be watching as they come round. TDRT and Piri are involved. How 3 AD lose out more. Oscar, go with GT3.
GT300 getting ready for their start here. Just about managed to get it double file. There's the green flag. It looks pretty even the start, although Core have gone to the outside of Western Wolves. Out of nowhere has... And Coombs is round!
Similar thing there, Oscar. I think somebody just little taps that sort of caused it. I don't know what caused that one. It looks as though there was just a little tap on the exit of the corner on Coots' rear wheel.
It was a lag tap between Coots and Gisella, is what it was, and it's just tapped Coots around to a point that he couldn't save it.
Speedo Racing are leading Evil. Where did Evil come from? Why are Evil in second in GT5? What happened when I changed to watch GT3 with you? Evil are right up in second position.
Friskops to the... Oh, don't try it. Please don't. No. Oh, well done. You didn't.
Well, that was a fast, frenetic first lap. Right there already. Price is leading for Speedo, though there might be some kind of talking to later on about that incident in turn one with my 3ID. Hillard is up in second for Evo, as I said. Fenyarvi third. Engel for Gen R has come up to fourth as well.
Where is your front row? It's gone.
Yeah, but the front row's gone. Screw qualifying. What does that mean
for anything? Qualifying's worthless. This track, qualifying means nothing. Oh no, wait, we said it meant everything. Never mind.
Darn it! Anyway, so I've got the GT3s to finish the first lap. Gisella with a good enough lead. What do you have?
Friskops round the outside of Barbosa, and he's gone and done it as well. Very impressive.
Whoa,
and now we've got Sayo. Oh, don't look there, please. Oh.
It's passing into the screen. Yep, so the wind is actually, as we said a minute ago, the wind is pushing them out.
Oh, Campas is round. Campas has gone off. And nearly hit Bert Knobs off. Yeah. Sorry for cutting you off there.
I was saying the exact same thing, I think, but yeah, anyway. Yes, the wind is pushing them out in the fast right hander, so expect some spectacular thing there. Spreading out slightly more at the moment. GT5 they certainly are, anyway. Hillen, what a fantastic start. I can't get over how he's got to second position because they were quite familiar. And there's a good battle going into turn number one, and that's going to be collision. Rude, Rassadin, and Maxis. And Maxis just drives past them both and gains two places.
And Ivanov.
And Ivanov is coming through as well. Iron Racing got a lot of damage on that right rear. All cosmetic, thankfully for them, though.
Didn't Savage start last? They're not last anymore.
This is a worthwhile point. Savage Simsports did start right in the back of the grid. In front of them was Last Lap Motorsports, both of them starting right at the back and now comfortably into the midfield. And there's a drive-through penalty just been given for our route, that's Sonic Realms.
I think it's the scan.
Could that be for not unblocking his messages? Yeah, he's not unblocked his messages, so that's that before. Bit silly that, when he was told to unblock and demonjigger chat, but oh well, obviously missed it and doesn't unblock, so that's be a drive through.
Oh! We've got Pinto gone round for last lap.
Oh, there's a three-car battle coming into the corner there.
Sensible driving from Pinto.
Yes, Pinto was actually in a good position there, so that's gone rather badly for them. So they're right in the back now in GT300. Well,
everybody press the clock message.
Oh, for crying out
loud! There we go!
Loud.
Way!
No, not everybody else!
Oh, that's 63 as well, apparently.
Whoa, loud contact. Saw that on screen.
And here, Luke Hammer's on the inside of Riegler, down into turn number one. FXR versus... don't keep blocking and unblocking messages, people! Come on! But Gahammer makes up back up to fifth position. He started fourth. He got caught out with the start there. And now he's got to try and pass the XR of Dominic Engel in fourth position just now. So we're going to be catching lap traffic very, very soon, which is going to be interesting because this should be entertainment at its best.
Joe Holmes has just gone off again.
Oh, Holmes off again. Battling his way through in 8th position just now. I'm sure he's driving a bit angry just now. But yeah, we're going to be catching the GT300, who are still reasonably tight together. So that would be interesting. Look at this, Vignarvi's actually at the back of Hillen as well. So this will be the first sort of contact point as to where how the lapping is going to be in this race between GT3 and GT500. So I think we should maybe look at this as they battle over second position. Smith down the sweepers to go.
When Yavi's nursing some rather warm rear tyres at the moment.
Race leader through the first GT300 now. On the back of another one which just stopped! Confusion there. Now it'll be certainly interesting here. They come, here come Hillen and oh, and that's Piri going very, very wide and being very, very nice to everybody and sort of dropping back like a stone, and he's going to hold Hillen up to the chicane, and that's not going to help him, but he's also going to be in the road of Vignarvi! Vignarvi's going to have to dodge him! Good driving for Vignarvi! Silly driving really for the GT3. There's a fine line between being nice and being stupid, but that really wasn't the brightest thing in the world to do. Just continue on your normal racing path. Don't stop in the middle of the chicane when there's only one line. And, oh, there's a crash! Price speed down! Price out! Price out! Price speed spun out! And there's cars and tyres all over the place. The race leader has gone off. A collision, it looks like, with Donalek.
Oh, we've got three about Holmes. Holmes on the inside of Reimer.
Oh, look, Holmes is going through. Wonder's going through. Donalek just drives off the track trying to avoid everybody. This is what I'm talking
it's
about.
Happening.
It's happening! It's Blackwood all over again! And I think the big winner in that is not Joe Holmes.
Oh, and we just got three wide over the bridge.
Oh, Joe Holmes onto fifth position. Opportunist driving at his best from Joe Holmes.
Isaac just got blocked in. Big time.
So Price has gone first for Speedo down to what?
Ninth.
Disaster, it's waited so long to get back on the track there.
Now I've got Holmes absolutely hounding Dominic Engel. And there's Joe Holmes, straight down the inside of Dominic Engel, setting his sights on Gahamut.
That's completely changed the order of the top five in this race. One lap of fun traffic.
Felix Hillen dodging and diving in between GT300s though, and probably somewhat confused as to why he's now running in first.
Yeah, Hillen's leading. Hillen's gone. I suppose Vignarvi's there with him as well still, but
Oh, and Coots, opportunist there, just goes straight past. Is that Ivanov? I think it is. Indeed it is. Good driving from Coots.
Traffic has put everyone back together. As you can see, Joe's not that far away now.
Oh, and Sonic Realms GT300 diving out the way over the curbs.
Look at this train of cars.
Look at Joe Holmes there.
Holmes is going to get through. Camera seemed to be a little bit slowed down by the traffic as they go into the chicane, and Holmes is through and up into third position. Is he? Yes, I think he is, yes. So yes, now he's chasing after second place. Look at this down the hill though. Oh, Gahamut's going to slide it to the side. No, he's not. He's going to avoid him. Oh, it was Ivanov there. He couldn't get out of the way there. They're all trying to go through like five or six wide. And this is... I don't know what to think of this, really. Surely they're all going to...
Dominic Engel's now right on Gahamut.
But he's going to try and get out of the way. Speedo GT3 needs to get out of the way. They do get out of the way. Eventually. And everybody's going to be fine, I think. Yes, they are. Yeah, okay. Woohoo! Riegler comes through now as well. So, it's actually quite hard to keep up track of what's going on here. But everybody's safe for now. For now is the key point, I think. Because I don't think it's going to remain safe for long.
The GC500s are barely looking at the throttle pedal through the laps at the moment. And here we go, Core GT500 is going to have a look at Sonic Realms GT500. Oh, I did not do that! Contact with Renault Coutts. Ooh, and Core getting a bit cut off there by Genaltis. Joe Holmes bearing... Oh, Joe Holmes is gone!
What? Where?
Here comes Gahamut.
Oh! And also look at this, Coots and Maxi's down the sweepers battling out. And Price coming through there as well. Yeah, it's also happening, isn't it? Holmes and Gahamut still fighting out with Engel right there with them as well. And Riegler. And this is all helping Eve, really, isn't it? Eve and Western Wolves pulling away at the moment and getting through the traffic quite nicely. Whereas everybody else gets held up and dies basically. It's it. The reason this is happening to certain cars is because they're in packs. And where's Gahamut going to go in the final corner here with Barbosa? He's going to try and get through, but Barbosa doesn't leave in the line. And Holmes is going to come straight back through. And Gahamut's going to be. Oh, Engel's going to take the ball!
Look at Engel!
He's going to get the ball! Surely. There's a car in the way. Holmes is going to dive. He's got to be careful not to take out the Popa car, and Gahamut's back to the inside at home. The Engel's getting nothing basically, and now he's got stuck by Popa. Oh dear. Oh crikey. Well, this is fast and furious. Engel is just jumping them both to come to third, and suddenly he's miles behind them again. Well, this is great. Well, is it great or is it just chaos? Is it
organized
chaos?
I've got no idea what's going on, so you can only assume it's gone well.
It's gone well because nobody's had a massive crash yet, apart from Speedo.
Leaders together.
And that's Gisella only just getting lapped, really showing how quickly he's pulled away from the GT300 pack.
They have a lot of clear track now. It's interesting to see who's fastest now.
Joe Holmes is on an absolute warpath.
GT is. It's not that far behind either, 5 seconds or so. Seems to have cleared most of the traffic now. We're not really talking about GT300 positions at the moment. It's quite interesting to see Gisella's actually got away from Wong and Peace, who are battling for second and third. So that's Vortex lean player zone who are leading. Oh, Holmes is going to get badly bumped there by the GT300 race leader. I think Vortex are out in God at the moment, and Matonis is causing, you know, he's just spun himself. Right, poof.
We can breathe for another 5 or so laps.
Well, kind of, because there's still a massive gaggle of cars sort of coming down the bridge section at the moment.
I don't think Isaac's actually that far behind. Everyone's just so bunched up.
Oh, and there's something going on down the back, and it looks like the toss fine every coming through. Oh, and this is going to cost Wong, is it? Peace is right behind him, and Price there too. Price
down, Isaac, where are you off to?
Down here's the grass. It sort of works. But, yeah, okay, right, okay, so Wong and Price, Wong and Peace, even Peace getting squirrely on the back of Wong. He's going to be very, very careful in this next right-hander, and he does lose a bit of time there. But that was all caused by lapping traffic and sort of using poor Wong as a sort of stopgap there to end their own battle. Oh, this is fast and frenetic.
I don't suppose you want to know that we're not very far into this race. Top 3 covered by 2.5 seconds in GT500.
Holmes is on the charge, despite his little bit of damage on the front end. Fenyarvi not really making a big impact into the lead of Evo, but I don't think they really need to with the championship on the line at the moment. They don't really need to sort of push, because they're
And here goes James Peace on one. Surely going to have a look with... Is he going to
Oh, here
work?
Comes the second virus car.
Yeah.
He's going to overtake.
No, I don't think he is. I think he's going to wait for the straight. And then he might go and help James Peace.
Oh,
but
well,
James Peace has gone wide.
That car's lagging horribly, so I think that'd be a disaster. Oh, they're being sensible. That car was lagging horribly earlier on, so he's okay. And he's a bit too far behind Wong, so he can't really dive bomb there. Peace got a bit wide on the draft, I think, there, in the fast right-hander. No time, Friskov from Western Wolves is closing in on them as well. So that's going to be an interesting battle between three cars in GT300. And just to say that, he loses time because Knops decides to go around the outside into the right hand.
Well, that means that Knops is now right on
Daskovic. And Knops almost sliding into Daskovic, but he doesn't. But Joe Hope's 12.93 and the other two 13.7. Oh, look at this! Hillen must have made a mistake because suddenly Fenyarvi is up the pace and is right behind him. In fact, Hillen 14.3, so really the Evo car suddenly struggling for pace of the
gone from 2.5 seconds to 0.7 seconds.
Yep.
Covering the top three in that lap.
Fenyarvi has much more straight line speed down the main, down the big straight into the left hander. So who's going to strike first, Fenyarvi or Holmes? You actually have to think Holmes, because I think he'll have the traction advantage off of the corners in the third sector. So is Joe Holmes going to go from last to first in less than 16 laps?
He's going to try for it. You can see him dabbing the brakes behind them. He's looking for that opportunity.
Oh, he's got an opportunity.
And here it is.
He's got squirrely. And this is going to be a good chance here for Holmes. But look at this. Fenyarvi's right behind Hillen, who's got even more squirrely and slow off the corner. So are we going to have a three-way battle into turn one? I think Holmes!
Whoa!
No, he's not. So it's just two. And it's Fenyarvi going for Hillen. He's got to be careful on the outside there, because Holmes is ready to pounce still. Fenyarvi, this will be braver on the outside. Yes! Brilliant! Vignorvi moves into the lead. Surely Hillard's still there. Woo! Hillard, thanks for trying to come back. That was a bit silly moving across. Holmes.
And here goes Holmes.
Holmes has got the run. Hillen cost himself so much time there. Holmes thinks of having to move, but that was nearly never going to work out. He just lost himself time there. So Western Wills and 3ID are 1 and 2 now, as they were on the grid. Down the hill. There's your front row again, Oscar.
Found it.
Found it, it's back. And it's on a charge. And Gehammer's catching as well.
Just had the 87 car spectate from GT300 because he was running the wrong restrictions for his car. Silly mistake, but one that is punishable by, well, not death, but getting no, you can't have a question. And here comes Holmes.
And so is Riegler, actually, as well, in the background of what I was watching a second ago, but Holmes is on the prowl for the lead, Oscar, isn't he?
He's jumping over the curbs. He's going to go for it here. I could put £1,000,000,000 that Joe Holmes is going to try for the lead here. And here's a GT300 though.
And Yorvi locking brakes so much there, and he's going to just drift wide, and he's going to have a massive flat spot. And Holmes has gone from last to first in 17 laps. Brilliant diving for Joe Holmes. So that completely changes the complexion of the race. I thought with Holmes having had the problem in the first corner, it might be. Oh, there's
a
car off, Perry's off, and they're coming back to Dunlink!
That's his own team car right there.
Oof, so that was a bit close. But as I was saying, I thought my 3D would be the fastest in this race in the FXR.
Got a three way battle in GT300. Something's gone wrong for Friskops, he's now behind GTS.
Yeah, Friskops miles back. He was fourth, and now he's eighth.
A large amount. A left hand damage.
Large damage. Wonder if he's hit a wall. Well, you'd have to assume he's hit a wall. He's down there with Coots and Pulper. Coots not having a good race today. Apparently, Felix Hillen is using automatic gears, according to Michael Booth, which is a bit strange.
Coots to the outside of Friskops is not going to make it work there. Oh, he is going to make it work there. Never mind what I think. James Peace having given up on his fight for second as well.
I wonder what's happened there, because they both suddenly sort of dropped back. Let's have a look. They were reasonably close, actually. Friskops has the damage there. Oh yes, then they go side by side. And Peace just sort of, Peace just forces Friskops into the tyres. Well, that'll be interesting after the race to see if Peace gets a little penalty for that, because he just ran Friskops off the road. If I was Roman Friskops, I'd not be very happy about that little move.
And Tossavainen, has he gone past Riglet? I think he has.
Yeah,
Riglet must have made a mistake.
He ran wide, as I said a few laps ago. And I think he must have got through there when the battle for the lead was going on GT500, so that was what's going on there. Pulper's causing a yellow flag.
Yeah, I think him and Renner Coots have gotten together.
Yep, Pulper has spun. Let's have a look at this one, I don't think it's a job of a replay system.
Being told off for my pronunciation for Eagler. Friskops has put his foot back down to catch back up to Renner Coots. Western Wolves versus Speedo Racing in GT300. Fifth position.
Just so you guys currently know, Vortex would actually be leading the championship right now.
Papa just went by himself, so he had nothing untoward there, just putting a wheel on the grass and around he went.
Core GT300 making some leeway on James Peace at the moment.
Yeah, Peace suddenly dropping off the pace a little bit. Certainly far slower than what he was doing in the qualifying race.
Well, far slower than he was earlier on. He was challenging second fairly recently.
19.35, nothing to really write home about as a fast lap at the moment. Oh, in fact, he's getting off track. Well, oh, just keeping out of the wall there, Peace. I'm surprised. I thought Virus would put form over challenge. I knew that a vortex would be.
We've got Dominic Engel being hassled by Tossavainen with Riegler right up behind him. Riegler, sorry.
There's a car! That's not gonna help! There's a car! Oh, they've all got round. Well, that was interesting. Was it backseat, I think? For some reason,
are you watching
very,
a replay?
Very slowly. No, I'm not watching a replay, Philip Diaz. I'm not watching a replay. No, down the bottom of the hill.
Savvy Sim Sports, yeah.
Oh!
Coming onto the bridge.
Oh, and that was a bit of a squeeze there for Tossavainen.
And Tossavainen, they're coming actually up to the Savvy Sim Sports car. But yeah, the Savvy Sim Sports car slowing down in a very inopportune moment. And look at this Riegler all over the back as well. Three-way scrap for fifth, yellow flag from Campar somewhere on this track. I think it's in the chicane by the looks of a slow-moving car there.
Baxis has cooked his rear tyres, it seems.
Yeah, maybe that way it was going slow, maybe it had a spin or something and was just recovering. Just didn't look like a place you wanted to let cars go through. Anyway, there we go, angle through. Toss a vine and down the inside, Riegler going through as well. All nicely through traffic, a little bit of a swirl for a Riegler. Recovering from his small off a moment ago.
Big wobble from Dominic Engel there.
So GT300 running away with Vortex are looking good to lead the championship after this. Random fins put together. Originally I think my unit is Koskinen, who's now driving for Genuine Racing. So he'll possibly miss that championship and by moving to Genuine Racing halfway through the season. But a very confident performance again for Vortex so far. Said that they just did a 20.5 and Wong did a 19.1, so it's down to 2.7 seconds all of a sudden the gap. Has actually got Peace now in the battle for third position in GT300. I can't understand why James Peace is suddenly far off the pace he was doing earlier on in this race. He just suddenly seems to have gone. Let's see if he has damage or anything. No, not really. Maybe it's a hot clutch though at one point. He's spinning! No, he's not. He's lagging.
Someone's connecting. It's
Oh, but he's off now. He is off now. And Barbosa's going to be up to third place. James Peace has blown it.
Safety car. His car rolled on the
bridge. His car rolled in the middle
of the bridge. Yeah, it's Tossavainen. Tossavainen's thrown it away.
It's a FZR.
That's got to be contact with the buggy wall. That's got to be contact with the wall.
It's got to be contact with the buggy wall and the car.
That's another car. Yeah, it has to be with another car.
I imagine that might have been Dominic Engel then.
I think it's more likely to be a GT300 as they came onto the bridge, the GT300 holding his line and him trying to go around the outside or something. Let's have a little look, I'll have a little look, you guys can have a little look, but I'll have a little look. And I can see a few GT300s right in front of them, so I think they'll catch the GT300s in an opportune place. That's exactly what I think should happen. It's Popa and GDS right in front, Tossavainen trying to go. Oh, Tossavainen just hits the back of him, and he does just hit the wall. So yeah, he hit the wall on the other side from what you normally expect a car to hit, and it's sort of sticking out and over he went, but really, just not really wanting to try and. It's like he didn't want to sort of waste more time by Popa, and he sort of just ran to the back of him, really just not looking at a gap, I suppose, is what you could say there, really.
Yeah, if you hit the wall there and get the bit going out, you just nosedive straight onto your roof. Which, it looks like that's what he's done.
How far are we through this race, Oscar?
We are exactly a third of the way through.
Which is going to be interesting. Because they can't make a driver swap yet, can they?
I believe they can.
Maybe just.
It's on that border, and very few people have been running the short first-in strategy this season.
Well, for a car that's damaged like Speedo and Westerwolf GT3, I think this is going to be good for them. But it's whether you want to put a slow driver. Well, I'd say a slow driver. You know, I'm thinking about whether who's going in next. Normally, it's a slow driver who goes in second, sort of thing. So yeah, but I noticed the 3ID have not come in the pits, so that's interesting. Here go the GT3s around the safety car.
None of something interesting here. Robin needs to come out of the pits before Giuseppe comes around. Or else he's a lap down.
It's Robin Fishcops, of course, of Western Wolves, so will they make it out the pits? Now. He goes, yeah, he's miles in front. But he hasn't changed tires or done driver swaps, so what they're trying to do is just get the most out of the tires and then do the driver swap at the hour distance, which seems fairly sensible at the moment, but Conquest Racing Conquest Racing could put Goik in the
Speedo
car. Goik's been not being very, very competitive. Speedo as well did switch. Karek is taking over for Price.
Someone's tapped Tossavainen back onto his the right way. Of course.
Cambars is pissed.
What is that car doing? It's the 63 of Piri again. Being very strange. I wonder if he just came out of the pits. He's just come out of the pits, but he was sort of stopped on the apex of the first corner when cars are coming through. Woofed. Dude's gone there, since now you're a lap down.
Car's all over the shot at the moment, so might be another lap or two under this yellow.
Yeah, I believe some of the GT300s, quite a few actually, need to overtake. Quite a few.
And there's Koskinen. I've got all excited for nothing. It's genuine racing now. I thought that was for Gisella.
After I just said, like, literally 2 minutes ago.
I'm not with it. I'm just not there. I'm not all there today. Robin,
oh, my goodness gracious me. I got Oscar. I'll describe this one to you, and you can tell how Tossavainen got back on his wheels.
How did he get back on his wheels?
Hitting the slate could hurt even off in Genuine. Don't know if they'll wait for everybody here.
Okay, so a quick rundown of the orders in this race. It got probably in this lap, apparently. 3RD leading a Western Wolves and Evo in GT5. Fourth are a Gravity. Fifth are ready to roll with Sonic Realms in sixth out of Virus, TDRT, Conquest, Speedo, Genuine Racing, the Reality Racing Team, Piri, and Savage Sim Sports Only Retirement, Car 07 Core Racing. And in GT300, Vortex lead PlayerZone, who lead Core, who lead Virus, who are now down to fourth. Chase Beast falling off the road just as the safety car was full, came out of the onto the track. And then it's Speedo Racing, Savage Sim Sports GT300, Mafia Racing, Sonic Realms Racing, Last Lap Motorsports, Western Wolves, Angel Power Racing, GTS Motorsports, Genuine Racing GT300, and last, Piri Motorsports, who are miles back and actually in the middle of the GT300 field at the moment. So we wait for this green flag to come out. Holmes letting the safety car go. The racer go at the white line / green cones for safety car restart. Holmes waiting to gun it.
I believe those cones just around the exit of the next corner.
Mm-hmm. Indeed, I think there's a red line there as well, which indicates something else, which I've forgotten at the moment. Anyway, here we go.
I think it's double file that indicates.
Yes,
but the line comes right after the chicane here.
Yep, here we go. Holmes leading the pack. Vignarvi trying to get past. Hill and Wright on the back of him too. The line is gone, and Holmes goes! And is gone at the start of this restart. Holmes completely caught, rest of them lapping. Hill and seemed more interested in being on the back of Vignarvi and then fell off it. Yes, anyway. So there we go. Oh, dangerous deep down the inside of Sonic.
Big crash.
That's a big crash.
There's been a huge crash back in GT300. And it's Friscops, who's just spent all that time repairing his damage and has been thrown back off again.
Yeah, what happened there? Similar possibly to the GTAL race a few years ago here. No real major order changes though. In fact, yes there is. Where's Team Virus gone?
Second.
Oh, well, there's a order change I completely missed. I'm trying to work out where they've gone. Are they gone up a bit?
Where are they? Are they out? No way.
There they are, they're second. Right, okay, never mind. Anyway.
Nopsis worked his way around Unitas.
Yep, Nopsis got around Unitas as well. Team Virus right behind him as well. Oh, Joe Holmes is gone at the start of this restart and is sort of, well, gone. He's leaving the rest of them sort of struggling in his wake.
He spooled up the turbo on the start and just went. Three wide, Goik, Kampas, and Malonen. Yeah, said that horribly. And Hegemon just in front of Karekas at the moment. Remember those two having pitted, and those around them having not pitted.
Goik has two. I don't know if he did a driver change though.
Yes, they did a driver change, yes. So that is...
Hegemon's gone wide, and Karekas has gone straight through on him.
Peace now has that 30-minute stint, kind of like what he did in the qualifying race. His tires are not cool, so maybe he can have that pace that he had in the qualifying race.
James Peace looks to be lagging a bit to me.
Oh, well, I tell you what happened in the GT3s. The race leader, despite being on go, decided not to go into the line. And despite the green flag coming out, the GT500 had gone, and basically Friscops came ploughing through everybody, so, yeah. Oops.
Bit of confusion on part of the majority of the GT300 pack there.
Reno Coops, just gonna pass for position. GTS Motorsports.
There was a few of them coming piling through, and... Well, that was not very bright driving from Fiskops, to be perfectly honest. Oh dear. Anyway, moving on from the GT3 incident.
Go on, mistake. Okay, hammers there.
Yeah, hammer hassling Hillen. Will he have a look down to turn one? It doesn't look like he's sizing him up for a move, does it?
Antonis is actually causing problems with Peace. It's actually on the same lap. So Matonis is actually racing these guys for position. I don't know how that's possible, but yes.
Well, Matonis' best lap is 2 seconds slower than anyone else in the GT500 field.
Robin almost rolled there, passing Rui Pinto.
Rui Pinto not doing a horrendous job. I mean, he was thrown to the back early on with a spin, but keeping it pretty solid at the moment. Matonis has just gone round right in front of the GT300 pack.
I don't. Yeah, they should have did a driver change.
Matonis has got no clutch, he's overheated the rear tyres. Koskinen beeping away at him, quite rightfully.
Anybody lets Lauris, so Koskinen goes off on his way, because anybody lets Lauris Matonis anywhere near GT1 is just asking for trouble.
And now he's holding up Pinto. That's letting Sonic Realms catch up to last lap Motorsports. What is Matonis doing? Is this any sort of 107% rule that he should be following in terms of the leader's pace? As Joe Holmes sets a new fastest lap of the race. And look, Matonis just dives in front of Fiskops, and oh dear.
I think he's going to get told to get the hell out of that car in a second. He's,
yeah, if not by his team, by the actual race administrators.
Well, I'm surprised his team haven't gone, well, you know, this is sort of... We're behind GT300 cars just now. I think the best thing to do is maybe take him out of there. And there's a car off. What's the other Savage Sim Sports car? Not a good time for them at the moment.
Can see a pattern forming here.
Don't like extra pits here. Surprised they're pitting this early. After the safety car.
Well, that's APR in the pit lane. Due to see Virus GT500 in this lap too. And there we go, there's someone to... Oh, well, there we were. Someone to take over from Matonis, it's Polar. As Matonis sets a 27.97 first sector.
Virus GT500 in, so that's a strange strategy. Couldn't have pitted a minute ago when the, when the safeguard was out, but I suppose it was a bit touch and go.
If Goit can actually keep a good pace. Him and Caracas. They can keep a good pace. They're not out of this race at all.
Koik and Caracas really can still win this race, looking at the pace just now. And as I say that, Koik goes wide, just avoids a wall, but Caracas is going to come through, I think. Caracas to the outside, he's got the speed advantage, and he's through. So that could be an important move. Koik, that's a dive bomb. They just backs out of at the right time. So clean, 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 clean. So Caracas moves past. That could be an interesting move, because if they can keep it a reasonable pace, then yes, of course they could win this race. Still, they've made their driver swaps and their pit stops, whereas the race leaders have not done so yet.
Turn one, lots of cars. Pinto, SR, and Mafia.
Got a little last lap motorsports train going on here. Rui Pinto driving the FXR, being hounded by Sonic Realms Racing and Mafia Racing right behind him.
Just a reminder, these cars are a little bit tight on the time limit for driving a certain the distance requirements of this race, but I think they should be okay actually. I think it's we're just giving the right time for them. So look at Genuine Racing, Speedo, Conquest, and the like, who pitted under the safety car, should be okay for the rest of this race, I think. Just.
I think it's a 60-minute rule, is it? You can't drive more than 60 minutes.
Hello, Friscop's up the inside of Koskinen. Just about making a stick there, but I think you'll get it on the pit straight. Yes, I think you should do. A little bit of a bump down the main straight there. Koskinen defending the inside line. Friscop's will go for the outside. That car came close. Anyway, Koskinen defend the inside. There's a Sim Sports car. Friscop misses his breaking point and runs a little bit wide, and that is the end of that battle. But Sipa coming out to the pit for Savage Sim Sports, very, very close, because he was just minding his own business in the pit lane, and all of a sudden, along comes Koskinen and Friscop battling it out down that main straight.
James Peace has recently set the fastest lap of the race for GT300, still right there with Gisella. And Genuine Racing, GT300, again, if they could keep a solid pace and get past these two guys in front of them, they are comfortably in contention for a decent finish, having made their driver swap.
Actually, GTS is the first with the pit.
I've just been told that GTS running. Pitted as well. And Hillen, where are you going? Dear God. Right up behind Wanyabi now is Felix Hillen. Went a bit mad down the front stretch, overtaking people on the grass. Okay, so Hillen and Wanyabi, it's going to be a close one.
There's a lot of people up in front.
Oh, hello. And now Bjorklund as well, they're right there with Bjorklund, who's a lap down.
And Yarvi around the outside. No, Bjorklund's
not
lap down, is he?
He's
missed about
for
a second, Oscar.
No, Bjorklund's a lap down.
Yeah, Bjorklund pitted. Friscop's time's out. Wonder if we'll see Westerwolds back. Hillen dives for the inside of Bjorklund, who's trying to go through. Who's trying to go through past the GT300 there. Don't know what happened to the GT300 of, was that GTS? I assume he was flying off, but aggressive driving from Hillen, who clearly doesn't want to lose out. So, Bjorklund lap down now. So, Gravity, who were right up there, now suddenly not. So Koskinen now is in GT3. Oh, Bjorklund's off. Bjorklund's going for a trip across the gravel there. But Koskinen has actually got into the lead effectively in GT. Oh, Westerwolf do come back with Bunby. Well, Mark, that's a new one. into the lead, sort of, are the people who have pitted in this race, so that's quite interesting. See how far Ursella is in front. Well, I think they're safe, actually. Ursella's gone off at such a pace in the GT300 after this start. I think they're safe. Holmes lead over Karekis and Goik. Well, that's similar-ish, so...
Been a bit of a crash, sorry, Chris, between 16 Compars and I think it was the Perry Motorsport team, 63, yep, coming out of the chicane. They were both off to the right-hand side, so obviously had a bit of a coming together there.
Mafia Racing, they've got a flat front right. Mafia Racing have burst their front right tyre. Got to be straight to the pit lane for them.
It's not even halfway in the race. Oh, Speedo spun.
Oh, Speedo's just gone straight into the pit wall.
Pygerman takes the first position up people's pit.
No, he doesn't. Goik's still there. Goik's in the lead now. That. So that's, did Speedo get there? How have they lost so much time for that? Oh, that'd be interesting. I'm just going to have a quick check of that.
Well, they broadsided the pit wall, the pit entrance, pretty much.
They have no damage, though.
No. Got the sweet spot right in between where the wheels are, so no physical damage.
Barbosa's got a flat front right tyre. I wondered why he went off straight on at the end of the bridge. I thought it was a bit of contact with some other GT3, but he's struggling to make it back, obviously, with the
front
right
gun. Yeah, that's GT3.
It's really strange, because we're halfway. Hillen must be pitting. No?
Hillen's looks like he's got some sort of issues going on there. He was just spun round.
Yeah, he lost to Riegler. Barbosa's losing a lot of time here.
Correct. What happened with Karekis is he just drove into the back of last lap motorsports as he was trying to come up to lap them. And they just spun. No. This is why Mafia's going to have a puncture, I think. No, it's not. Okay. Never mind. They just basically spun around and away he went.
Yeah, I think Mafia did just overdrive it or lock up a few too times. Few too many times.
Yep, so it's going to be interesting to see if Holmes and that come out in front of Goik. I think they should actually get out in front of him, but we'll just have to wait to see.
It's going to be massively close.
Comes around about 20 seconds, so it could be close. And then it'll also be interesting to see how quickly Lahaikkanen gets up to speed in the 3RD Gaming FXR. Here he comes into the pits. Holmes, race leader, into the pit lane, down to the pit lane speed limiter. Good entry for him. Sabi Venyarv taking the lead for Western Wolves unless he comes into the pits. We haven't seen anybody come on the server for them. He's into the last pit box. Bit of a slow entry there for Holmes.
Goik's going to get it. Easily.
Let's see, when will Holmes start revving? He'll start revving.
Goik's got it. In fact, is Hydrogen going to get him as well?
So this is going to be interesting to see whether Thready can come back through. Really, that really has cost
pass too.
Speedo as well. Speedo will have four flat tires. Flat spot tires. Speedo aren't quite going to get there, I don't think. No, they do not. So then, 3RD have a bit of work to do suddenly, all of a sudden, to claim this victory. Suddenly, Conquest Racing are looking in a good position to win this race. 33 laps to go, and 3RD need a charge.
Yeah, and Goik's a more than adequate racing driver. I mean, he's very, very quick. He's proven that all season long. So Lahaikkanen's going to need to be going as quickly as Holmes is going. And with Karekis on the better tyres,
Karekis has got the run as well. Karekis has got the run. Knowing Christoph Karekis, he'll
indeed
want to have
a
good. And he does. 3AD tried to hold around the outside, but they knew Karekis was going to sweep across. So 3AD down to 7th position. So it's all going wrong for them.
It's an effective 4th.
The strategy at the moment looks as though the correct one was to come in the pits during the safety car.
Well, the safety car, it ran over the... I'm not 100%. I think it ran over the 30-minute marker.
I think it did, yeah. I think they should be okay. And it looks as though Ursella's going to be coming in the pits as well. So Koskinen and Genuine Racing, screw what I said about them looking though they were clear, Ursella and Vortex. I think they could be behind as well because the FXR takes a bit time to get the fuel in as well. So 34 laps to go in this race, and we could be all change all of a sudden.
Wong's
the comfortable leaders before the race started, and Wong is spinning apparently.
Pitting
even. Phil Diaz is making.
Yeah, Lombardi taking over for him. You've got to think that, well, I think Gisella's the quicker of the two drivers at Vortex. So they're going to keep him in as long as they dare.
So into the pit lane will come Vortex this time around. Ooh. In he comes.
Never mind anything that comes out of my mouth.
You're not paying attention to what I was saying like 30 seconds ago. They were pitting on this lap, Oscar.
And so is Peace.
Peace pitting as well. So then, it's cost 26.9 seconds. Is the gap.
Easily for Koskinen then.
Peace has tried to block him in, but hasn't really done a very good job of it. Gisella shoots. Koskinen's going to do it.
Good job of blocking him in, because he had to slow down more himself to make the blocking than just
there goes Koskinen!
But it's a lot closer. Latin Mackie not far off.
Yep.
Board today is going to get rowdy, but not Latin Mackie.
Yep, so the order is Genuine Racing. Ooh, Campar's almost hitting Rauti as he came on the pit. So the order is Conquest, Vortex, GTS somehow in third position. They've just quietly got there. And Virus down to fourth with Player Zone in fifth position. So it's all changed here in GT3 and GT1.
Well, you did think this before the race.
Into the pits comes Racing on GT500, but really they seem to be a bit out of it today. Western Wolves, Dennis Lind will be taking over from Matti Venjarvi. Into the lead goes Riegler for Ready to Roll. That's going to be close to the lap mileage in a second, I assume. But yep, it seems as though Knox in the pits, so Goy could be moving up comfortably into second position.
They've currently got probably another 3 laps until they hit the 60 minutes.
I think what we did at Blackwood when there was also a safety car is we removed the safety car laps, or the sort of time extra spent on the safety car laps, so they may...
Ah, in which case, you've got another 5. Heidemann makes a mistake.
The first stint by Conquest GT500 was 31 minutes, so it just depends on how long or how quick they can do their laps in the second stint.
There's something's gone on with Karekis again, because Lahaikkonen's now a good 3 seconds ahead.
Indeed it has. And he's sliding all the way. So we missed that one. Karekis dropping back down to 5th position now.
And Lahaikkonen going like stink took a second out of Heidemann in that sector alone.
I think Kerik has for Speedo lost the 3 seconds on the previous lap when I think, was it Chris maybe said something about him at turn 2 or was that?
No, I don't think so.
Deco said it in my other ear. Yeah, he had a bit of a moment out of the chicane.
Having Koskinen in a GT300 FZR for Genuine Racing, though, much stronger a driver to have there. I mean, he's been the guy that really played the part for Vortex getting up front earlier on this season.
I just looked at the map and saw another car spinning or having a moment at the chicane, and I managed to find out it was Karekis of Speedo again. He might have got a bit involved with the lapped car that was close to him. And with tyres everywhere, and he's lost another 3 seconds in the first sector there on this lap.
He said he hadn't practiced with 80% fuel. But I don't think that's really a reason to make a mistake almost every lap.
So Goik leads for Conquest, second Heidemann for genuine racing, and the gap is 4.3 seconds, and Goik lost 1.1 seconds of traffic on that lap, so Hydrogen actually closing in at the moment. I'm being informed by Dominic Engel that the wind makes this setup feel even worse than it did before, so congrats for that, Dom. Third place, my 3ID on a bit of a charge, though at this present time, charging to try and get the wind back. Fourth, Speedo Racing having a bit of fun in the chicane again on this lap, which though Lint appears to be catching them in the battle for fourth position. Ready to Roll are in sixth position with Sonic Realms, seventh, Evo, who were leading at one stage, down to eighth now, with Virus 9th, Danish Racing Team 10th. Gen Gravity Racing 11th with Piri 12th and Team Reality in 13th with them. Well, with them. Savage Simsports also in the race at the moment, but they're miles behind GT3s for some reason still, so they're struggling away.
Well, so far on this lap, Lahikkanen has made up. About over 1 second. Let's see what the gap is when Hydrogen comes to the line. That's a 15.3, and the Lahikkanen is a 14.6. The gap's down to 2.6 seconds here in the battle for third. That's what I meant, Phil. I meant seconds, yes. Being corrected there.
Conquest being held up badly at the front. Yeah, Mark Bumby with the has a white XRR for us at the moment, probably the same for you guys watching. Just be to do with them timing out and then having to rejoin quickly.
Again, Hydrogen catching on this lap. Goik is having no luck with the traffic and we catch them, but Hydrogen's not going to get any favours in this last corner behind the battling Bunby and Radosep. Be careful to leave enough room there, and that will probably give Goik a bit more breathing space, but still came down with 1.6 seconds, so the gap is 3.5 seconds now. So could Hydrogen catch? Only XR in the field catch Goik and Conquest for this win.
I think Lahikkanen's more likely,
getting close as well.
Yeah, it's more likely that Hydrogen's going to be under pressure by Lahikkanen. That's 1.5 seconds on that lap, but then Lahikkanen has to lift off there and through the sweeping corners here to pass the GT300, so he's going to lose a bit of time on this lap.
Kiss is on pressure from Lynn down the back straight. There's GT3 in the way as well. Lynn, you'd have to favour. We'll go for the inside. Crack is making sure there's just about not enough room for Dennis Lynn to come up the inside there as he was passing to GT3. So this is the battle for fourth position. Speedo and Western Wolves. Western Wolves having a difficult evening of racing, it seems, today. But fourth place would probably be pretty nice for them in their championship challenge.
Yep, Lahikkanen lost another 1.1 seconds that lap. Just traffic. I mean, really playing a huge part.
I think genuinely in GT3 must have had a bit of an incident. I think it was Team Evil going a bit slowly. And now I see that genuinely Racing lost 3 seconds compared to their second place rivals, Team Vortex. Team Vortex in the second split.
Yep, so it could be life in that battle as well.
Oh, and Perron, it's a bit of contact with Genya Racing GT3 in turn one. So that's not exactly going to help Koskinen make up any time over the battle behind. That's an 18.6 at the first split. When the guys behind are doing a 17.8.
Latin Mackie under some real pressure from Bordeaux at the moment.
car spawning the sweepers. I don't know how on earth that happened. It's Capal and APR. He seems to be getting back going again okay now. And Piri are off in turn one apparently as well. They're back on now in GT500. That was a curious crash there for Capal. Down in the sweepers. I shot a tire from I was watching Heijeman's car and I shot a tire. I had to look back and it was a spinning car.
Dennis has got around Chris.
And Lint has passed Karekas, yes. The outside, he got held up there. Did Dennis Lind on the back of his teammate for this race, Mark Bunby, and through goes Karekas again up to fourth place. I can see Dennis Lind be very, very unhappy about that. But here comes Lind taking all the curb in the chicane. He's got it done, and he's got the run on Karekas still. Karekas defending the inside line. Lind for the outside. You can pass around the outside off turn number one, as we've seen in this race. Oh, there's a GT300 there as well, but they're gonna. Oh, terrific. Didn't even make any kind of contact there. And it looks the Lint is going to just hold the position up to fourth place. Karekas gets a bit sideways, but that was top-class driving for those two drivers to not make any kind of contact there at all. Just leaving each other enough room.
Top three now lapping pretty much the same as each other. Heijeman a tiny bit quicker, but not very much. He's quite close to Heijeman. Life in that one, yep.
Goyk almost loses out of the final corner as he jumps across the curbs and
whoa,
the grass.
Whoa, there's a collision! Karekas has spun! Karekas has spun out the Grav T car. For some reason, Karekas seemed to think it was a good idea to go through the middle of two cars that were already side by side in the double left-hander, and Grav T's hard second half of the race has continued. That was a bit silly from Karekas. I haven't given him all the praise for his incident with Dennis Lint there. But yeah, that was impatient and unneeded driving. Gap's down to 2.7 seconds actually, Boothie, from the race leader Goik to second place Heijeman. Leikkanen not making as much inroads as you would have thought he would be at the moment. It seems though that gap has sort of stabilised a little bit more.
Yeah, Goik came across, or got sort of side by side in the final couple of corners with Speed Racing GT300, but didn't really have enough to make the pass and then had to jump over the grass and the curb and then, oh, and as he makes contact with Miro Rauti makes contact with him. Well, that was interesting. You see that one again.
So Heijeman's right behind now, and Goik's head swirling. Where's Goik going? Goik's off, and it's the link goes Heijeman surely. He's going to come back on, and he's spun. Goik's around, and Heijeman leads. Goik, what's going on? What's wrong with Goik? He's stopping. Goik's stopping. Something's happened to Goik. Steering wheel or something, maybe?
Calibration of his wheel.
Calibration, possibly, in the collision with Rauti. And Goik has dropped to third position. I don't believe it. That's so unlucky for Conquest there. And suddenly, the lead changes again in GT500. It's something genuine racing and leading this race.
He's off again, turn one.
He's off again. Something wrong for poor old Conquest Racing. Have stopped again in turn one. Trying to recalibrate this wheel, I think they're going. Something terrible has happened to his wheel. Oh, this is disastrous for Conquest. I don't quite know what to say. Oh, Redusev again is very, very close to the side, swiping his car. Why has this happened?
Yes, he's off the at least he's off the track a little bit. So it's not like we probably need a safety car at all. And yeah, he's got going now.
And now
seems like he's given up. Yeah.
So it's a retirement for Conquest Racing, having led this race with just 20 laps to go. Unbelievable.
Well, the battle now for first is between Leikkanen, who caught up 4 tenths there on that lap, to Genuine Racing and Heijeman.
Yeah, indeed there is an advantage. FXR against XR. The only XR in the field is leading this race. I didn't expect to see that today. But poor old Conquest, who seemed as though they had it all under control. Here we are on board with the FXR of my 3ID Gaming in second position.
It's the battle for GT300 second place up ahead as they go past the GTS Motorsport car. FXR drifting not as good, I would say, as Samson Giovanni, as we saw at the last round. He needs to work on that.
This lag issues for car 51. Oh, straight to the middle! There's the lead changing for the Heikkinen. The Heikkinen takes the lead by going straight through the middle of the GT3 and Robin Heidermann. So my 3ID Gaming, a brave, brave move there from Heikkinen to take the lead back down the bridge straight. There was very little boom there, using all that bus to get through there, get through the gap. Well, it was very dangerous, actually, to be honest. But there we go, there's the lead change. And it's my 3ID Gaming who've been last, first, fifth, third, second, all over the place today. And now suddenly they're back in the lead with just 19 laps to go. And I don't think Genuine Racing quite have the pace to be able to strike back at this present time. Flat front right tyre for car 63. That was the car, I think, actually, that came back on the bridge complex, actually. So that's also explaining why he was so slow down there. Apparently some lag issues with car 51, which is Western
Dennis.
Bulls.
Dennis has been passed over in again by Caracas. I don't think they want the position.
You are battling, watching the battle for third position between Speedo Racing and Western Wolves for third in GT500. There's an FX and there's an XR GT300 up in front of them. Got to make it around clean. No, they don't. Yes, they do just make it through cleanly. Desley almost understeering into the side of the Sonic Realms GT300 car there. Heikkinen, in one lap, has got a 1.3 second lead over Heidermann. You're really just showing the pace of this FXR today here at this track. In GT300, it seems as though Genuine Racing are maintaining the gap over Vortex, first and second down there. Drive through and then stop go for car 17 Perry coming out of the pits there, not using the speed limiter for some reason as they drove out of the pits. And Heikkinen getting very badly bulked there, but Speedo also apparently getting held up even more by Leighton Mackey in a Vortex car. And is this a chance for Dennis Lane? You bet it is. He has a chance on the outside again. where he passed the last time for having a problem going, oh, Karekis is outbreak himself, and Linton's got down the outside. Who's going to blink first? It's surely having to be Linton, and it is Linton. Karekis just leaving him enough room on the edge of the track, unlike before when we saw another car and the Western Wolves GT300, which eventually ended up backing into a wall. So there we go, Karekis remains third, pushing up a hard defence. Has cut out his errors that he was making a little while ago, and now seems to have got more into rhythm, having repassed Lint, which we didn't see on camera, I don't believe. For now, what is their position after the retirement of poor old Conquest from racing? It seemed as though they got spun around by the Virus GT3 car. Oh! Isaac Price back on the server. Speed Racing gonna have to make a drive or change.
I think
again.
They are, because I'm looking at their stats. The first stint was only 29 minutes.
Yep, apparently they are gonna have to make a stint. Yeah, you're right. Yep. Oh dear. That's unlucky. I suppose that the I was listening to Dominic Engel talking about how he made the decision to do one lap more just to get it just over the 30-minute mark. Well, he needed 30 minutes and 4 seconds or something like that. But Speedo pitting immediately has not paid off for them. And are they adding fuel or something? It's a long pit stop. Something gone wrong there for Speedo again. I think something, if it was just straight driver change, I think they'd be gone by now, and that's a disaster for Speedo. Should still come out in 5th position though, so it's not all bad. But got over 10 seconds behind 4th place, ready to roll racing, so Speedo out of the battle for 3rd, and it appears quite easy now for Western Wolves to pick up 3rd.
Well, there is going to be an interesting battle behind them though, for 6th place, as Sonic Realms Racing's GT500 FXR, driven by Neil Conway, seems to be coming under pressure. Is going to be caught soon by Team Virus and Team Evil.
Yep, Conway doing a smashing job today. I think this is a track that he knew better than the last race, which was his debut. And he's really doing some nice laps at the moment.
Yeah, that was a custom track, which was... I don't think he was as prepared, so he's probably done a bit more practice and knows this track better.
Yep, good battle going on here, surely, and Schneiders is right there as well, actually, Booty. Having dropped back from leading this race earlier on.
I saw a change for position, but it was Savage's GT500 passing Vortex for second.
Second in GT3. Well, yeah.
Oh, Perot was wide at turn 5 onto the bridge. He loses the position to Schneiders of Team Evil. I think the lap car of Lombardi got in the way a bit. Conway of Sonic Realms managed to get ahead before the sort of fast corners, so he was able to eke out a little bit of a gap, but the others got caught up behind him.
Forgive me, I've been away. What happened to Goik?
Wheel failed when he got spurned, apparently, by Virus in GT300. And then his wheels completely failed, and then... yeah, it's all gone wrong for them, sadly.
So it's a bit like, no wheel, no.
No wheel, no! No wheel, no! There's a car there! No, there wasn't a car there.
No, Llama, no!
No, Virus, no! You've been over... No!
Oh,
GTS!
Please.
GTS! No, GTS, no! You've timed out!
That's Speedo Racing up third.
Yep, Speedo Racing up third in GT300. GTS had such a good run going as well. As that Schneider's getting blocked in. Yes, it is, by the dude GT300 ahead of him. Perron has a chance to come back, and Conway has a chance to get away.
Depends if GTS managed to cross the start-finish line. If they did, then they might not have cost themselves too much
time.
Oh,
Perron getting held up massively by their own GT3 and the Sonic Realms GT3. Perron in the wall! Perron hits the wall, unsteering behind his own GT300.
You yeah, looking at the tracker, GTS managed to start that lap. They're only 7 seconds. Yeah, about 7-9 seconds ahead, behind, sorry, the GT3 leader, but they're going to fall back a few positions with that timeout.
Yeah, shame that, really. I do wonder if they did put in extra fuel or something, because I think it would be a bit quicker than that at this stage of the race, but I could be wrong. Apparently I am wrong, so maybe just traffic or something.
Maybe just fresh tires.
Fuffle going into turn one, the last lap motorsports car, trying to get out of the way of a few cars that are coming through there.
GTS complete their second lap after their timeout, and so they've gone from third in GT300 down to ninth. But we're only about 4 seconds behind Savage Sim Sports GT300 team, so they might be able to catch them back up.
Massive damage, and that's a shame. And he's struggling to brake for the next corner. Maybe he's got a bit damper damage, maybe that's possibly costing him. But nose is up, so I don't think he'll be scraping along the ground. Just needs to reset himself and get back into it. He's gonna hit later, Mackie. He's gonna hit the GT3 second place car, and he's gonna lose out to Tutvari now. He's just calmed down, Donning Realms GT500, and just take stock and get back into a rhythm. He's going to get right on the back of Tutvari, so here's a chance to immediately strike back on the Danish racing team. Chooses not to. Down to turn number one, so down to ninth for Sonic Realms. Again, the SRDT 300 car off. just needs to get in a rhythm again. Okay, so a quick run through the order. Leading at the moment, My3ID Gaming in the FXR, Genuine Racing second in the Only XR in the field, Western Wolves are third in GT500 with Ready to Roll Team on their debut in fourth, Air Speedo Racing in fifth, Team Evo are sixth with Team Virus seventh, Danish Racing Team eighth and Sonic Realms ninth, Piri Motorsport tenth, the Reality Team are 11th, Craft T Racing Team are 12th with Savage Sim Sports now I think ahead of the GT300 again in 13th. And in GT3, Genuine Racing are leading this race ahead of Vortex. Vortex looking good for the championship lead, I do believe so still. Speedo Racing are 3rd with Team Virus 4th. 5th are Players Own, 6th Angel Power Racing. Core Racing are 7th with Savage Sim Sports in 8th. 9th GTS Motorsports with Mafia Racing in 10th. Last Lap Motorsports are 11th with Sonic Realms in 12th. Western Wolves after their timeout are only in 13th position with Piri in 14th. And our retirements, Conquest Racing after that horrible wheel failure while leading the race, Core Racing in contact with the GT300 while lapping them sent them into a barrel roll, and Herba Racing Team disqualified for trying to cheat and using their own restrictions. It's the best way to describe that one. I wonder if they were doing that in the qualifying race as well. They should have even been
Were actually doing that, unfortunately, in the qualifying race. I think they got in touch with the admins and they had their own... They were complaining they had their questions unanswered before the race, but unfortunately you shouldn't be asking before the race what your restrictions are. As we see Perron and, oh, almost a car over there, that was the gravity car going sideways at the chicane.
Loads of tyres through.
I'm not sure what Bjork was doing, he was a lap down.
Yeah, Price has got massive rear tyre failure, so he must have gone off somewhere as well.
Yeah. I was about to say, Player Zone is right up behind Virus now in GT300.
Battle, yep. These two seem to be battling all day, Player Zone and Virus, in their respective cars. Though Piece of course did fall. I wonder if Virus's setup is better at the start of his stint than the end, because really, both drivers seem to have gone off like a rabbit at the start. I was going to say a scalded rabbit, that would be a better eulogy, but anyway. At the start
that wouldn't be very real, it would be dead.
Yeah, no, anyway, I don't know what I was thinking there. I was trying to think of a good one, I couldn't remember the term for something that's scalded. But anyway, Virus seemed to have gone off at the start of the stint very, very well, and just be eaten back into by the other cars in the rest of the stint. So I wonder if their setup was better at the start than the end, which would explain why Peace was so fast in the qualifying stint, because he didn't have to go to the heat peak or anything like that, or maybe something like that. But later on, it seems to be slower than my setup. But anyway,
well,
can they hold on?
That's the kind of thing you've got to work out if you're a team from the qualifying races, whether you can use the speed at the start of the stint and make it through the qualifying race. But then when you get to the big race, then you have to do... it's Bumby, I think. His lag went away there. Just looking, and when the main race, you have to do a longer stint, so maybe you may compromise yourself in the main race with that kind of strategy. Which you see Gesunis going on the grass outside of the final corner to try and overtake Mark Bundy, which was never going to work.
Dominic Engels joined, and that's for Robin Heidemann, second place GT500 car.
They must all suddenly be panicking that their
strategy
isn't going to work.
It's not 30 minutes. If you get one driver 30 minutes over, you don't want one driver 60 minutes over.
Yeah, so you've kind of got to work out how long you think the second stint is going to be, given your sort of average lap and then sort of how many laps you're going to do. So just take a bit of calculating, especially when there's a safety car that comes out and you really want to pit under the safety car, but you've got to make sure you get a minimum time. As
oh, after the bridge here.
Yeah, that was Hydraman going a bit wide, and then his GT300 genuine racing car teammate making contact with Neil Conway of Sonic Realms.
So suddenly Westerbilt's going to be about to steal second position and even help themselves even more in the championship challenge.
Hydraman couldn't change gear there. I think Hydraman might have some technical issues.
I know his field's been acting a bit funny recently, so I wonder if something's going on there again. And maybe that's why they're having to change driver, because the angle's gone over the 30-minute threshold. So, or driving, so...
Yeah, and it wasn't fuel or anything, so...
Lombardi almost getting on two... Well, he did get on two, but he was almost rolled it there coming out the final corner as he was battling with Miro Rauti of Team Virus.
Dominic Engel for Genuine are only back to third. Still a really solid finish for them, considering the current position of their GT300 car. Could be an all-round happy weekend for Genuine Racing. Matt and the Ready to Roll team, which is also Genuine Racing affiliated.
Oh, Engel's gone off from third position. I wonder if he'll just be able to stay. Anyway, I'll be way ahead of Casuna still, but Engel not having a happy time getting back in that car. Looking a bit underprepared. I suspect he's honking his horn all over the place as well. Much to be careful he doesn't roll the car or something, honking the horn there, Dom. Oh, crikey. That looks horrible to drive at the moment.
Is that the 9-car horn or is it a different one?
No, it's a different horn, it's not the 9-car horn. I would even blare the 9-car horn if I hadn't been taken from behind by another car in the qualifying race.
Judging by that honk, I think something may have gone on between Bell and Zada and Engel.
Well, Dom's been honking the whole lap, so unless the world has done something to Dom, I don't think it's that.
Dommy always thinks that the world's done something
that,
to him.
The Speedo GT300 car, Bell and Zada had actually made contact and after the bridge, that's why he went off. I thought you'd seen that, that's, yeah.
No, I've not seen that, okay. Well, Bellandanda's actually got massive damage to that left-hand side of Speedo Racing XR GT3, so, yeah. On to the penultimate lap goes Jarno Laikkanen and My3ID Gaming. I'd love to say it was a dominant performance, but it's not been a dominant performance. It's been a scrappy
Isaac
affair.
Price, sorry to interrupt there, Chris. Isaac Price is going up the hill after the chicane. Going for a picnic, as Chris Wilkinson would say. So he has
not the
lost.
First time he's been that.
He's lost two positions. Yeah.
He's about to get lapped by Laikkanen. Clutch damage as well for Price. Rauti still battling as soon as it behind them. That's not going to go well, Gladius. He does manage to keep it. Oh no, he doesn't manage to keep it out of the wall. He eventually hits it. Getting caught in the draft. These two battling down the hill. We're on to the final lap in GT500. 3ID looking good for the win. Lombardi up the inside of Rauti. Side by side. He's got it done. I think it's going to be game over there for Virus. Here comes Gasunis down the inside.
I'm not sure why Gasunis needed to do that.
Oh, Gasunis, you monumental moron.
He's a good few seconds ahead of the car behind, so I'm not sure why he needed to actually pass those two cars.
Pass and then do a squeeze
yes.
as well.
And the only thing he could have gained there was a penalty, which if there's a protest, he probably would, looking at that incident. And the... is that the GT300 leader that just pitted?
Yes, it is! So they might lose... Have they lost? They have.
They lost two places, they're down to third.
Wow. Anyway, you're like going to try in the final corner. He's going to win, there's no question about that. My3RD Gaming, the class of the field today, no doubt about that in the FXR.
But Ivanov's just gone really wide, now Rousey's got a run.
3RD win, but we're going back to Ivanov and Rousey.
Shades of KY2R. These two teams were fighting out on the final lap there, separated by just...
Rowdy going for a little bit of a loop, but he doesn't get it done. Ivanov looks safe, I'd say, right now. That's a disaster for Genuine Racing, really. And that's really gifted a title opportunity to Vortex now. As Vortex takes the checkered flag in GT300. They only led on the last lap and last stint. There we go, Vortex, checkered flag. Second place for Speedo Racing GT3.
And it's going to be third for Genuine.
It'll just be Genuine Racing. They just got it together enough on the last lap to take third ahead of Rowdy.
Just not putting enough fuel in, and he's slowly coming across the line, running out of fuel. That's why he dropped back from the battle there.
And he got spun round.
Okay, I didn't see that.
No, he got spun round the last lap. But anyway, there we go. And there's Ben Keogh finishing as well. And Speedo. Right, okay, so I think we're finished now, are we? Everybody's crossed the line. That was a crazy finish. An absolutely crazy race. Crazy last few laps. Phooft! Victory for My3RD Gaming. Somehow Western Wolves finished second. Genuine Racing dropped into third. Ready to roll for now, fourth, despite, well, dodginess on the last lap there. Fifth place for Evo. Perron, sixth for Team Virus. Danish Racing Team, seventh. Speedo dropped to eighth ahead of Sonic Realms, the Reality Team. Perry! Then Savage Simsports did actually manage to beat Grav T on the last lap as well, so crikey. Claudius Cassino is saying sorry for the contact with Lombardi. Well, yes, you probably should be for that little manoeuvre. That was interesting. Don't know quite why you do that, really. But anyway. Oscar, would you like to run down the GT300?
Indeed I would. If you just give me a moment to switch back to my tracker here. So, through some luck, some speed and... a great number of accidents and miracles, Vortex Racing have brought home for another win this season, and I believe that that puts them to the front of the point standings in GT300, although obviously that would be provisionally, with various other things needing to go on. In second place was Speedo Racing, in third was Genuine, a bit unlucky for them, but third position is pretty good nonetheless. Team Virus were fourth, with PlayerZone coming home in fifth. Core Racing, after an eventful race, managed to hold on for 6th, with Angel Power Racing doing a nice job of getting 7th. Savage Sim Sports came home in 8th, with GTS Motorsports, unfortunately after having such a good run, only managing 9th. Mafia Racing came home in 10th, with Last Lap Motorsports behind them in 11th. Western Wolves came home in 12th, Sonic Realms Racing 13th, and Piri Motorsports a further 3 laps behind in 14th, with Herber Racing Team being disqualified fairly early on.
Phew. So we thought Blackwood was a bit nuts, but this seems to have been as nuts.
In the first half of the race, I personally was sweating. Just watching it.
No, but yeah, I don't know what you mean. I mean, it wasn't so much dangerous driving, it's just the nature of the track makes it seem like that, I suppose.
The track, I can see, obviously, it's not as thin as we think it is. You can get 3 cars alongside, but it just, when you've got all the cars there at once, it looks about 1.25 cars wide.
Yeah.
It's just...
I don't know what to think of that race, really. I think that It was a bit chaotic. We saw the power a safety car can have at Super GT, I think, as well. That was quite an interesting little twist there on the race.
It was. It looked like for genuine racing, they just bottled it at the end with their timing.
Yeah. Shame, really. A little gamble like that really should... It feels as though that should get rewarded rather than sadly punished in the end, but yeah.
Solid result with two-thirds for them anyway. And then 3ID, I mean, like you say, not the domineering performance that we were expecting, but they fought back twice from being quite a way back to go and win that by over 20 seconds. You've got to hand it to them, they really were on form today.
Yeah.
As is expected from my 3ID, they should be on form, a team of that caliber. But a good job from them, a fantastic job from Western Wolves to persevere in that GT500 car and bring it home in second position. That was interesting.
I think the memory from this race I'll take away is Joe's move to go from 7th to 4th, or was it 7th to 5th or something, down the sweepers.
It was fantastic racing. Like, there are a few idiots and a few moves that were more than questionable, but all in all, I really enjoyed it. I'm not convinced that the drivers did, but from a spectator's standpoint, it was fantastic.
Right, okay, that'll do from us, I think, for today. My voice is going even worse. Remember, these results are provisional from today, where you shall see how, well, what protests come in for various bits of silliness that happened in this race. Join us again on the 19th of February, 2 weeks' time, for West Hill Reverse. 20 laps qualifying race, 60 laps main race. Cloudy afternoon. That would be a very interesting one to join us for. So thank you to Oscar Hardwick, to Philip Diaz, to Michael Booth, and to the rest. And to you, the viewers, for watching this drama. And yeah, thank you very much. See you next time. Goodbye.